In later life, he said, "Cheadle, perfect Cheadle, my consolation in all my afflictions."
When Cheadle was finally consecrated, it was a national and international event, attended by bishops and archbishops and ambassadors. Cheadle was a vision of the future, a template for what the English village church would be. But for me, it's also like stepping inside Pugin's brain. It fizzes and pops, constantly working, constantly active. Who would have thought that the character of a man could be captured in a church?
Pugin didn't just build churches for Shrewsbury. He remodeled his country seat on Gothic lines too. And it was from here that the two men worked towards a romantic reunification of the English church, hoping to create one that was devoutly Catholic, uniquely English, and totally Gothic. It was a vision which, like Shrewsbury's old estate, was destined to fail.
This ruin can be taken as a metaphor for Pugin's dreams for a more moral Catholic Britain. But if it's a metaphor you're after, Shrewsbury's great family seat is now Alton Towers.
With its high-speed rides, thrills and spills, ups and downs, it's the perfect metaphor for Pugin's life from now on. They might have deplored his conversion to Catholicism, but Anglicans were starting to take note of Pugin's work. The library at Lambeth Palace, the official residence of the Archbishop of Canterbury, holds one of the few surviving original copies of Pugin's second great book, The True Principles of Pointed Architecture. Published in 1841, it lays out six principles for building in the Gothic style, and I've come here to find out what impact it had. Timothy Britton Catlin is an expert on architecture and on the Gothic revival in particular.
His first book is about how good architecture is the result of good society. This book is a book for architects, and it tells you how to do it. It's an instruction book, and it explains very carefully the overall principles, right down to the details, of how architecture should be designed and made so as to be consistent with his vision of a good building and a good society. The two go together. That's very central to Pugin's message. The smallest detail must serve a purpose or have a meaning, he says. You turn each little bit of it into something which expresses not only the message of the building, but also its constructional and its structural role.
So long as it's part of the construction, you're allowed to decorate it.
You are, even if it's a very tiny part of the construction. One of my favourite examples is of a set of hinges. Pugin is comparing a modern door hinge, hidden between the door and the frame, something you never see and never really think about, with a beautiful wrought iron hinge of a Gothic door. It's expressing the material that it's made from. It's got something of the human touch of the person that made it, and it's expressing the openingness of the door, the dooriness of the door, as it were. All that just from one tiny piece of metal.
So back at my home, for example, I think all of my doors are on these hidden hinges.
Yes, you want to get rid of those right away.
They're completely immoral.
They're completely immoral, yes. You'll be in trouble there. Yes.
Oh, right. This is a book of passionate feeling.
Yes.
I mean, it's a highly emotional, highly charged book.
It's also very funny. It's a very funny book. His books are hysterical. He's a very good writer.
What are the funny parts?
Well, he always has a good insult. If something's not a miserable expedient, then it's an abomination. One of his rudest jokes is to mix up the work of very good architects, so Nash and so on, with the work of third-rate architects, all together in the same picture. So he's saying, all these classical people, they're all the same. It's all rubbish. It's all a bit silly. Whereas, you know, Gothic architecture is not the person that matters, it's the thing. It's the thing that matters.
Mm.
It's the physical nature of the construction. And that's why it caught on, because it made sense. Pugin talks a lot about truth. And what he means is that buildings should be honest. That's to say, they should be the thing that they appear to be. And there is a sense here all about that God is looking at your building, and God goes round the back. And if you used cheap bricks round the back, he's going to know, and he's going to be cross.
It's a question of morality.
Yes, it's a question of morality. And in fact, in many ways, that's one of Pugin's most lasting contributions to architectural history, that a style of architecture could be more moral than another one. That's a completely new idea. No one else has come up with that before.
So whether it's a church or a house or a railway station or a hospital or a school, all of those should be built in accordance with the true principles.
That's right.
And increasingly, most of them were.
Increasingly, most of them were. There is a new generation of architect. They believe every word that they read here as almost as if it's gospel. George Gilbert Scott, one of the most influential architects of Victorian England, said when he read one of Pugin's books, "I felt as if I'd been awoken from my slumbers." And he changed his ways immediately. And within 5 years of True Principles coming out, you can see Puginite architecture right across the country.
Thanks to Pugin, Gilbert Scott and others, the early Victorians built a wave of new Gothic-style churches, railway stations, schools and town halls, transforming the landscape of Britain and inspiring subsequent generations of architects right into the 21st century. The work of today's high-tech architects, like Richard Rogers and Norman Foster, has its foundations in Pugin's principles of making a building reflect its use and of putting the user at the centre of the design process.
Modern high-tech architects often talk about this period, the mid-Victorian period, as being the one that inspired them. It's the one when the architect was in control of every last thing, when they were doing it out of a strong desire to change something completely. It's a very powerful chapter in architects' collective consciousness.
London's burning! London's burning!
In 1834, a fire burnt down the medieval Palace of Westminster. Good riddance was the response of many, because it had come to stand for a whole culture of political corruption. It was decided that the replacement should be in the new Gothic style, which presented Pugin with the opportunity to stamp his moral ideas on the very seat of British power. And Pugin's expertise was instrumental in helping the architect Charles Barry eventually win the commission. The work of both men is clearly evident in the finished building. The rhythm and symmetrical layout betrays Barry's classical training and instincts. But the Gothic details, veins that catch the light, carved stonework, and the spires are undoubtedly Pugin's touches. And Pugin was to have an even greater influence on the interior design. Dr. Mark Collins, the palace's archivist and historian, is here to show me some of Pugin's work in the House of Lords.
Mark, hello, I'm Richard.
Oh, Richard.
Very pleased to meet you. What an amazing room.
Yes, we're standing in the Peers' Lobby, which is a place where members of the House of Lords can gather before they go through these doors into the House of Lords chamber.
How much of this is Pugin?
All the designs in here, the designs for the floor tiles, the stained glass as well, heraldry features throughout the palace. Mm. Pugin loved heraldry, and it's in all the main rooms on the principal floor.
These gates are more like screens than gates.
They are a spectacular example of the work of John Hardman, who made all the cast brass throughout the building, and also the stained glass as well. This is almost like the choir screen that you might find in a church.
It also gives you a kind of semi-religious feeling about government, do you think?
Yes, I think so. Yes, you have a hierarchy of spaces right the way throughout the palace, yes.
Can we go in?
Yes. They're very heavy, these gates. They weigh 1.5 tons altogether.
You are once again surrounded by Pugin's ideas, in this case, and his idea of power.
Yes, it's meant to overawe the viewer. every single surface is covered with carving. On top of that, you have painted decoration and gilding. In fact, he said that he made over 1,000 drawings for the wooden panelling in here alone.
Really, 1,000?
With a whole palace as his canvas, Pugin was in overdrive. Barry described him as working with 50 horsepower of creation, and he urged Pugin to slow down, lest he make himself ill. Yet the massive workload didn't compromise Pugin's vision at all, especially when it came to the sovereign's throne.
It was tradition that wherever there was a formal throne or seat for the monarch, then there would have been a canopy over him. It has a great deal of imagery on it.
I see.
You have the orders of chivalry, which are depicted by these little knights in armour. And behind the throne, the cloth of state, as it's known, which is the royal coat of arms. It's not cloth, of course, it is carved wood in this case. It's all oak.
Actually, it makes you think of Arthur and Guinevere and Knights of the Round Table and a sort of Walter Scott view of the Middle Ages.
It is a deliberate revival of English history, making the Parliament here a special case, separate from those on the continent.
The extent of Pugin's contribution led some people to claim that he, not Barry, should be viewed as the true architect of the Palace of Westminster. Just look at this design for an imaginary college, drawn by Pugin in 1834, the year the Houses of Parliament burnt down. The resemblance is uncanny. However, Pugin was destined to be written out of the palace's history for decades.
Charles Barry drew in all the drawings from Pugin without actually making a public acknowledgement of the work that Pugin had undertaken. So Pugin simply remained Barry's ghost, and he was really written out in the early guidebooks to the palace, for example. He wasn't mentioned on one single occasion.
Not once?
No.
It was undoubtedly in Barry's interest to sideline his collaborator, but Pugin himself contributed to his own undoing.
He had no interest, really, in his reputation. He had no ability to manage publicity or to build his persona. And he liked to please people. He did the whole of the Palace of Westminster, really, because he liked Charles Barry and didn't want to say no. So he did what he did and was largely forgotten.
Pugin missed out financially as well. While Barry received nearly £25,000 for his work, Pugin was paid a paltry £800. A commission that should have set Pugin up for life thus became just another job. Worse still, despite the popularity of the Gothic style that he had helped create, Pugin found his architectural work drying up. Anglican rivals were being commissioned instead.
Then came another hammer blow. Louisa, his second wife and mother to five of his children, died after a short illness. Pugin was devastated. He became increasingly manic, sparkling with new ideas one moment, sunk in depression the next.
Now aged 32, Pugin would struggle with mental illness for the rest of his life. His eyesight began to fail, and lurching between exuberance and paranoia, his manic behaviour would become evident in his work. He moved to Ramsgate, and it's here that he produced the third of his great books, An Apology for the Revival of Christian Architecture in England. The book, a strident defence of Gothic, is Pugin's least coherent, a product of his increasingly violent mood swings. But it builds on the ideas outlined in True Principles, applying Gothic design to all forms of building and every aspect of interior design.